Thank you. And so before I start with my talk, I think it's a good time to thank the organizer for this nice week. So I'd like to. Okay, so in my last lecture, I'd like to discuss representation with solvable image on a special manifold. And so, namely, I'd like to discuss the following result of Frédéric. So, you take, as usual, not now, so in a compact complex manifold in C, which is either a weakly special or Brody special. And if you consider a representation of its fundamental group, so in Gn of C, and you ask that it has a solvable image, so representation then, in fact, because the variety is special in one of these sense, so G will be the image, then G is necessarily virtually abelian. Okay, so my goal of today will be to give a proof, I mean a sketch, but give all the main arguments, all the ingredients of the proof of this theorem. And note that if we have this theorem and the theorem that I explained yesterday, in fact, it gives a solution to the conjecture I gave at the very beginning. So it says that every local system of geometric origin on a special variety has virtually abelian image, okay? Because well, if I have time, I can give the details, but this is an easy consequence of this and of what I explained yesterday. Okay, so but first, I'd like to discuss the Albanese map for special manifold. And so let me recall briefly what is the Albanese. So we'll start with any compact complex manifold in C. So I can define a map from the first homology group to the dual of the one form, global one form. And this map is just, if you take a cycle, you associate the. So you can integrate a one form on this cycle, and so it gives an element of the dual. Okay, so here that I use nothing. But now because X is in C, we have a Hodge decomposition in degree one, and from this you, so first yeah, let me remark that this map is almost injective, so its kernel are just the torsion element here. And so if you quotient this by its image from Hodge theory in degree one, you see that you obtain a compact complex torus. Okay, so it follows from the Hodge decomposition in degree one. That if you define the Albanese variety of X as the following thing, okay. So as I said, it's quotiented, in fact, by the quotient of this by its torsion. Okay. So that this thing is a compact complex torus. Okay, so the only thing that you need to verify is that this is a discrete and co-compact lattice in that. Okay, and it's complicated. I mean, if you think about it, it's a direct consequence of the Hodge decomposition in the Q1. Okay, and so this is called the Albanese variety of X. And now if you fix a point in X, then you get a canonical holomorphic map. From X to its Albanese, and the map is given by this to an element. You associate the integration along any path going from X to X0. So a priori, there is a choice in the cycle, but this choice is killed by the quotient. And so this map has a satisfy a universal property, namely, so for any. So the map depends on X naught, but if you change the thing, it will just change by a translation in the Albanese. Yeah, but indeed you need to fix X naught to. Okay, so for any holomorphic map from X to a torus, so to a compact complex torus, there exists a unique morphism of complex tori, so from the Albanese to T, such that you have a factorization. So we have X to T, X to its Albanese. Sorry, I forgot something. I want that this map send X naught to zero. Okay, so it's a torus, so you have zero inside, and so I claim that if you ask this, then there is a unique factorization like this. And as a morphism of tori, so by this I mean that it sends the zero into the zero, and in fact it automatically this implies that is. It is compatible with the group law. Okay? So this is a universal property of the Albanese. And so we will need this. So I don't prove it, but it's an application of Hodge theory. And the second property that we will need is the following, which is much easier, is that if you look, so I will, the Albanese, I will note it like this. So this map induces an isomorphism. So if you take the H1 of ALB, so you need to take coefficient in Q and to the H1 of X with coefficient in Q. So this is pretty clear from the definition. If you look at this, so this is a complex vector space, and you divide by a torsion-free lattice, Okay, so the H1 is really the torsion-free lattice. So if you tensor by Q, you really obtain H lower 1 Q. Okay, and just dualize. So this is an easy exercise. Okay, so these are the general properties of the Albanese map. And so let's now look more precisely at the Albanese map for a special variety. And here we have the following remarkable result. So I fix X in C, which is either weakly special or Brody special. So the claim is that then the Albanese map. So of course you have to fix to have a well-defined map. You need to fix an element, but it will be the same up to a translation of the Albanese. So it's not very important here. So this map is surjective with connected fibers. And something that I won't use, if you ask moreover that X is really special, then Frederick proves that it has no multiple fibers. Okay, so this is a very nice fibration. So this is what people call a fibration. And if X is moreover special, then you don't have multiple fibers. Okay, so, yeah. So let me give the main ingredient in the proof of this result. So there are two main ingredients, so I will state them. So first, this result. So if you take any irreducible variety so say of a torus, okay, so a closed subvariety of a torus, any kind of singularities, but irreducible. But I ask that it is which is B special or weakly special. So I define this only for a smooth variety, but so here I just mean that one desingularization satisfies the thing. And for B special, it just means that already in the variety, there is a dense, Zariski dense entire curve.
So in
this
in the torus?
Yeah, in the torus. Any closed irreducible subvariety of a torus, which has this property, is in fact very special. It's a translate of a subtorus. Okay, so I won't give the proof, but let me just comment. So there is a general statement of Ueno that Frederick recalled. So if you take an irreducible subvariety of a torus, so we have X inside T, then there is a general result of Ueno saying that, in fact, X will be fibered in abelian variety over something of general type. And I don't give more details, but this is a general statement. And so from this statement of Ueno, you directly get the part for a weakly special. Okay, so the proof is is direct application of Ueno structure theorem. And for the case Brody special, what I'm saying is that if what I'm saying is that the Zariski closure of an entire curve inside an abelian variety is a translate of a subtorus. And this is exactly the so-called block OKI theorem. Okay, so this is just a reformulation of a classical result, but seeing this way of presenting it is quite nice. And second result, so now you take X, a normal compact analytic space. Okay, so you take a normal compact analytic space, which is so the same weakly special or Brody special. Then the claim is that any finite surjective map from X to a torus is necessarily étal. Okay, so in particular, X is also a torus. Okay, so this is quite remarkable too. So still, when I say that this normal compact analytic space is has this property, I just mean that a desingularization of it has this property. And so if you have a finite, a priori, ramified map over a torus, in fact, it's unramified. And so it has to be a torus. Okay, so now how do you get the, so maybe yes, some names. So in the case where it's weakly special, this is basically a result of Kawamata and Viveg. Okay, so they proved it in the case where the Kodara dimension, asking that the Kodara dimension of X is zero, but I mean from their proof you get this statement. And the second case is due to result both of Kawamata and Yamanoi. Okay, so how do we get the first result from these two? I mean, now it's easy. Okay, so I want to look at this Albanese map. So first, I a characterization of. So I don't understand. What is the character? Ah, you mean? Yeah, maybe I don't know. Ah, okay. I see what you mean. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let's prove this result. So we begin with the Albanese map with X special. So we take the image. Okay, and so by the first result, we know that it was translate of a subtorus. Okay, but now by this, you see that in fact it has to be everything. Okay, by the universal property of the Albanese map, you cannot factorize by a torus. Okay. So in fact this is equal. So the first map is surjective. And now you want to prove that it has connected fibers. So it's a proper map. So you do the Stein factorization. So this one has connected fiber and this one has finite fiber, is a finite map. So you want to prove that this map is finite. So now, because this one is surjective, this is still special in both sense. Okay, and so you are exactly in the situation of this result. So telling you that, in fact, this map is not only finite, but it should be etale, and why it should be torus. And still you apply the universal property, this should be an equality, an isomorphism. Okay, so yeah. But of course, these two results are, I mean, you need to work. A big universal property. Yeah. Okay, so this is for Albanese map of special manifold. So now I will go to the proof of Frederick's result. Of the theorem, and I will need some preliminaries, so some important fact about fundamental groups and their representation. So the first thing is what is the result due to Selberg, and people call it usually Selberg's lemma. Even if, I mean, could say it's a theorem, but it's a nice result, and it says that any finitely generated subgroup of GLN of C for some n admits a finite index subgroup which is torsion free. So this is a very nice lemma because it tells you that if you geometrically, if you have a representation of the fundamental group on some X, then you can look at the image of the monodromy. In fact, going to a netal cover of X, you can make the, and pulling back the representation, you will get a new monodromy representation, but now the image will be torsion free. Okay, so this I will use it a lot. Okay, so yesterday we saw a similar lemma, Minkowski, but Minkowski you need to arrive in GLN of Z. So when you arrive in GLN of Z, it's more elementary because if you add a level structure, this will do the job. But this one is more general. Any finitely, more general in one sense because you need the finitely generated. In Minkowski, you don't ask any. I don't know. No, I don't think you can. No, I don't. No, because you will find. You can find some matrices of any order. So you need some condition on the. So if you know the field of definition of your representation, then you might say something. But okay, so this is the first fact. And second fact. So in the first lecture, we were looking at the following situation. So let's say you have a fibration from X to Y. So fibration, I recall it, it means that it's surjective with connected fiber. And between two compact complex manifold. And so the goal is to look at the corresponding, the induced map on fundamental group and say something. And so the lemma tells that, so yeah, everything gets nice if you put some orbifold divisor. So with orbifold divisor, so delta, and so it's orbifold in the classical sense. Okay, so this is the notation of Frederick, so with classical multiplicity. And so the claim is that in this situation, then there is an exact sequence of group. Okay, so of course you have a map from any generic fiber to the fundamental group of X, and there is a map to the fundamental group of Y, but in fact it factorizes by the fundamental group of the orbifold, I will define it, and it's surjective. And so the claim is that, well, first this factorizes, but more importantly, it's an exact sequence. So let me just define this. Okay, so assume that, so by definition, delta, you put okay, so over every divisor such that you have a multiple fiber, you put the GCD of the order, the multiplicity, thank you, okay, of the irreducible part. And so what is the fundamental group of this? So this will be a quotient of the fundamental group of the open part, and it's a quotient by the normal group generated by, so each time you have so geometrically, so we are on Y, we have this divisor, and so I want to look at a small loop around the divisor. And so this will be a T, and I will put T, so it's around delta I, so I will put T to the MI. Okay, and this is a normal group generated by. Okay? So it's a quotient of the fundamental group of the open part by a normal group generated by some torsion element. No, not by torsion element, by this element, sorry. And so I won't prove it. You can try. So essentially, the main case that you need to prove is when Y is the disk, and you have a singularity only at the origin. So you can try to look what happened here. Why is this, I can give the ID. So if you are on this, so here you have the singular fiber. The thing is that because of the multiplicity, you see that if you take something like this, its image here will be a multiple of the generator of the puncture disk, of the fundamental group of the puncture disk. And the multiple will be exactly the multiplicity. But now, because you have one for each thing, and it's what you obtain is a subgroup, in fact, the subgroup that you get is really generated by the GCD of all the multiplicities. Okay? So this is basically the proof in this case, and then you need to extend that. And so what will be important for us is the following corollary. So in the same situation, so fibration, from X to Y, any representation from the fundamental group of X to JLN of C with torsion-free image. Which is trivial on the fiber. In fact, it factorizes. So not only through the orbifold basis, but in fact, really through the basis. Okay, and so the proof of the corollary, if you assume the lemma, is trivial. It goes as follows. So you have an exact sequence of group. So you take the fundamental group of the orbifold. So clearly you have a surjective map to the fundamental group of Y.
Y delta.
Hmm?
Y delta, not Y.
No, no, it's what I want. So I say that from the fundamental group of Y delta, there is a map to Y.
Oh,
and the thing is that here you should put a T, okay? If you kill the meridian loops, then you get the fundamental group of Y. And what is the kernel? The kernel is generated by the T's. Okay, but now the T, if you see them here, they are torsion. Okay, so this is a subgroup. This subgroup is generated by torsion element. Okay, but now if you look in the representation, because I assume that the image is torsion-free, then all this element, I mean all this subgroup, is sent to the identity here. Okay, so this factorizes. Okay, so it's it's a very nice criterion to verify when you have such a factorization. And so now we can really begin with the proof. Okay, and so what we want to prove, in fact, is that if you begin with it, so what is the, we have x in C, and we take a representation with a solvable image, so G, solvable. And so we want to prove that G is virtually abelian. And so what we will prove is that up to replace X by a finite etal cover, in fact, geometrically, the map, this representation will factorize through the Albanese map. Okay, so strategy. Up to replace X by a finite etal cover, rho factorizes through the Albanese. Okay, and so if we can prove this, then we are done because the fundamental group of the Albanese, it's abelian.
That's complete.
That's what?
So which map factors
that? The representation. The representation factorized through the Albanese. So meaning that this representation should in fact factorize through. So what we want to prove is this. Okay. So it seems very strong, but in fact, a posteriori, if you know that the fundamental group is abelian, then using this lemma, it's an exercise, you can check that automatically, geometrically, it has to factorize through the Albanese. So it's really what you have to do. But now, the good thing about this statement is that you have more geometric tools. Okay, so now let's go with the proof, really. So first, by Zellberg-Lehmann, one can assume from the beginning that the image of the monodromy, so that G is torsion-free. So let's assume that. So now we have the following situation. So Albanese from X to Alb, and I will call now A, this thing. Okay, and so so using a rho, I have a surjective map to G. So G is the image of the representation. And if I restrict this map to a generic fiber of the Albanese, okay, so I take A here and XA is the fiber. Then I will call H the image. Okay, and so the lemma tells me that what I need to prove is that this image is trivial. So we need to prove by the corollary it is sufficient to prove that, so a priori it is sufficient to prove that H is trivial, but in fact it's even sufficient to prove that H is finite. Okay, because if you know that H is finite, then by going to a Nettle cover of X, the corresponding H will be trivial. Okay, so and this says that you will be able to make the factorization, but on this Nettle cover. So each time I'm allowed to take a finite Nettle cover. Okay, so this is the first reduction. Now, second reduction, in fact, it is sufficient to prove that the abelianization of H, so quotient of H by this is finite. So let me give the idea. This is easy. Indeed, so because G by assumption is solvable, then any subgroup is solvable, so H is solvable. Indeed, H is solvable. And so solvable means that it's an extension, I mean iterated extension of abelian groups. Okay, so let's write it as an extension of an abelian group by a solvable but group, but with a, I mean you need less step to make it abelian. Okay, so this one is abelian. Okay, so if we can prove that the abelianization of H is finite, then a fortiori K should be finite because it's abelian. So H shall be finite implies that the cardinal of K is also finite. And now by the same kind of trick, you can, going to a Nettle cover of X, you can make K trivial. Okay, so there is a small thing to do, but you believe it. Okay, so going to Natal cover, this is trivial. And so now by induction on the number of extension, you're done. Okay, well, there is a small argument, but it's really nothing difficult. Okay, so what now I want really to prove is that the abelianization of H is finite. So now we begin with the geometry. Okay, so we are in this situation. So we have the map to the Albanese. So remember that we have seen just before that it's a surjective map with connected fiber. Okay, because X is special. Now I can look at the smooth locus of this map. This is an open subset and the pre-image. And so this is still a fibration, but now smooth. Okay. And I will fix an element in the base and fix an element in the pre-image. Okay, so X should go to A. Okay, so this is the restriction to the smooth locus. Okay, so we know that we have, on this smooth locus, we have an exact sequence of fundamental groups. So the fiber at A goes to this, which goes to, yeah, I should put the base point. So at X, computed at X, and now A, computed at A. And it's surjective. Okay, and this is an exact sequence of a group. So now I just restrict the representation. So I add this representation from phi 1 of x to g, which is surjective. So I just restrict it here. So you have a surjective representation. Now, by definition, here this is h. And it's also surjective. And this is a subgroup. And it's normal also, so I can define the quotient, and it's surjective. And there is a factorization like this. Okay. Okay, so because of this exact sequence, in particular, we know that this is, so the image of this here is a normal subgroup. So I have the action by conjugation. Well, I don't need to put it the same. Okay, so this is the action by conjugation. And so I have the surjective map on G. And I have a corresponding action. So I have a morphism this is H and this is G. Okay, so I have a surjective morphism of group. Here I have an action by this group, I have an action by this group, and the two action commute. Okay. Now here I have the abelianization, so H1 of the fiber with coefficient in Z. And this is surjective on the abelianization of H. Okay. So in particular, we get an action of pi 1 of this here and of g here. Okay, but now, because this is abelian, if you look at this, in restriction to this subgroup, the conjugation action is trivial. So it factorizes through an action of this one. Okay, so we get the following diagram. Okay, so the next step is we have xz, and I say that this the action of this one, in fact, factorizes through the action of the base. And similarly, so we have HAB, and this factorizes this through the action of the quotient. And here it is surjective. This is very important. Okay? So if I dualize this picture, so we get, so I dualize and I take a Q coefficient. And so we get an induced action of the base on this Q vector space. And by this diagram, so this is a sub-representation of, so we have the action of pi 1 still of the base on this. Okay, I'm just dualizing this diagram. But now the thing is, so here I have a representation of the basis on the cohomology of the fiber. And in fact, this is nothing but the monodromy representation of the local system of the H1 of the fiber. Okay, so this is the monodromy representation of the local system R1 Albanese of the sheaf Q. Okay, and so we have seen that this underlies the variation of Fock structure, and so in particular, we know that the algebraic monodromy group of this thing is semi-simple. Okay, so by doing, so its algebraic monodromy group is semi-simple. So this is true for this one, but this is also true for the sub-representation. Okay, so semi-simplicity works if you restrict to a sub-representation. But on the other hand, we know that by, let me write it. So on the other hand, so we know that this representation factorizes G over H. Okay, so this is from here. And G over H, it's a quotient of G, so it's also solvable. Okay, and so yeah, it is solvable, and on the other hand, is the Zariski closure should be semi-simple, so there is no choice, it has to be finite. Okay, so solvable plus Dyski semi-simple implies that G over H is finite. So similarly as before, taking a finite index subgroup of G, we can make this group trivial. So by going to finite etal cover, so of X, we can assume that the action of pi 1 of the base on this is trivial. Okay, so now we are close to be done. So therefore, just a reformulation of this, we have proved that this Q vector space is a subvector space of the monodromy invariant degree one cohomology. And so now to conclude, I need to do two observations. So first, so if I look at the induced map on cohomology from the Albanese, I have this map. So the map from the Albanese with coefficient Q goes to the cohomology of X with coefficient in Q. And you can also restrict to a fiber. So I said first that because this is the Albanese map, in fact, here it is an isomorphism. And because this, the composition factorized through a point, it is zero. This map is zero. Okay, so finally, this says that the restriction map from H1 of X to a fiber is zero. Now comes the finite point. This is the linear invariant cycle theorem, so which tells you that in this situation, so we look at this restriction map. So clearly, this factorizes through the invariant for the monodromy. Inside here. But so Deligne tells you that in this situation, when you have a smooth projective map over an algebraic basis, this map should be surjective. Okay, so this is Deligne, what is a global invariant cycle. Okay, so it's a very general theorem about smooth projective morphism. Okay, and so I claim that now we are done. So why? So I claim that on the one hand, the restriction to this is surjective on this, and on the other hand, it is zero. So from these two facts, it follows directly that the invariant of the monodromy, so from this and this, it follows that the invariant by the monodromy is zero. Okay, but all the constructions that I made before say that this is a subspace of the invariant polynomodromy. So this implies that the after taking Q coefficient, this is zero, and this is finally implies that this is a finite subgroup, and then you have all these reduction steps, or this finishes the proof of Campana's result. Okay, so you see, yeah, it's really Hodge theory which is behind. I mean, so the yeah, I get the where you the two main ingredients are this one, and we have used also another theorem of the line telling you that the image of the monodromy is semi-simple.
Really, it proved finite or only virtually abelian?
So the thing is, I should finish the proof really. So we prove that H abelian is finite. So I explained that going to Etal cover, this proves that H is trivial. So this proves that the monodromy representation factorizes by the lemma, which is not here anymore, the representation factorizes through the Albanese. But now you use that the Albanese as an abelian fundamental group. So this says that it could be non-abelian, yes. Here we really use the specialness of X. So there are more general results where you don't use specialness and say, so there is a result also of Delzant telling that in big generality, if the image is solvable, then in fact it's virtually nilpotent. Okay. So here with this technique, we cannot say anything about the fundamental group a priori because it has not to be linear. Okay. Yeah, so there are many works, but I think it's a nice illustration how you can get this kind of result using Hodge theory. But there are other techniques, of course. Okay, so let me stop here. Thank you.